Thank you. Like Phil said, we are with the KPMG Forensics team out of Chicago. And before we get started, I just want to mention one of our other team members from KPMG Forensics team out of Chicago, Ken Johnson, who couldn't be with us here today. If you guys were at the memorial service yesterday, the site at the bottom is a website that we set up where people can give their condolences to him. And it's just amazing, the response. The comments are on the side. You scroll down and then you click for more, and you can just keep scrolling and clicking and scrolling and clicking. It goes forever. And I just want to thank the DFIR community and SANS for their response to this. It really showed what kind of a community we are from what they did. So getting started with this, presentation actually began whenever I attended the Elasticon World Tour conference in Chicago. So Elasticon is the main Elasticsearch conference in San Francisco, and they did a world tour hitting many major cities in the US and Europe. I got to go to Chicago, the one in Chicago, and that's where I met the developer of the Python library for Elasticsearch. His name is Hansa Kral. And I went up and talked to him, and I said, hey, I use your Python library. It's awesome. I don't really have any questions for you, but can you show me something cool? And he said, have you ever used the Elasticsearch DSL library? And I said, no, I've never heard of it. So he showed it to me, showed me all these cool features for it. And I go, okay, that's cool. And checked out the other stuff at Elasticon, and with all the visualizations and great presentations, highly recommend if you guys are into Elasticsearch and they do that again, definitely check it out. I kept this in the back of my mind, and we actually were able to apply it to some of the stuff we're doing in Forensic Lab in Chicago. So since this is just a 20, 25 minute talk, we have a few assumptions. We assume that you have Elasticsearch already deployed and that you've ingested forensic artifacts in Elasticsearch. If you have any issues getting started with those, find me afterwards. If you buy me a beer, I would love to talk to you about how to do those. We also assume that you have the Python library installed. There's a command to do that. Just type in those letters, hit enter, and you're well on your way. So the Elasticsearch DSL library, we're going to be using Python, but the same functionality is available in many other languages. There's objects in the DSL library language. Today we're going to be dealing with queries, aggregations, and searches. The really cool thing about the DSL language is the query objects, they can be combined with Boolean operators. So an ampersand for and, a pipe for or, and a tilde for not. And we'll go through some examples of what we can do with that. These DSL objects can also, all of these can be deserialized to a dictionary. And if you guys aren't coders and the word deserialize is kind of intimidating to you, it's real simple. We'll show you an example of what's going on. And it supports every type of query that Elasticsearch supports, but we're going to be focusing on query strings. If you've ever used Kibana, you've used a query string. And the other thing about Elasticsearch DSL is if you do implement it, don't be surprised if it works flawlessly with Django, because Hansa Kral, the developer of this library, is also a core Django developer. So let's say we want to make a query on file execution. So this is how we would start. We import the library, and we import the queue object. And then here is how you would build a query object. And we're going to use the artifact prefetch. It's a great artifact to see if file executed. So you make your query string right there. And then this is how you deserialize a query object to a string. And then we can print it out. And this is what it looks like. This is what's called the body string. And this is what is sent to Elasticsearch in the HTTP REST API. And as you can see, it's pretty basic. There's just a couple of brackets, and you got your query string right there. But this can get a lot more complex, as we'll see. So here's a second version of that query. Let's say we want to add on a little bit more. We want to bring in more artifacts. Let's say we have a Windows 8 and up machine. We have AMCache available to us. So we can just create another query object with the artifact type AMCache. And then we can combine those two together with a pipe. for a Boolean OR. So we're going to say artifact type prefetch or artifact type amcache. And then that builds a new query object with the two of those. Again, we deserialize it. And this is what you get with your body string. Grew significantly. We now have a should statement in here with two conditions. There is a Boolean OR in between the artifact type prefetch and the artifact type amcache. So let's take this another level of complexity we'll add to it. So this same query, but with amcache, it tells you all DLLs that were loaded with amcache. And I love that. I love the verbosity of that. But let's say we want to filter those out for example's sake, and we just want the executables. We can build a query for paths that end with .dll. And if you can see, it's kind of small. At the beginning of the query, there's a little tilde for the Boolean not. So our query condition is going to look like this, where Q0 is the artifact type prefetch, or artifact type amcache, and not path ending in DLL. So we deserialize this to a dictionary. And you see where I'm going with this. This isn't very manageable. If someone asks you, can you take something out? Can you put something in? Managing all these curly brackets and braces would just be a nightmare. It doesn't really scale. And so actually, whenever I wrote my first complex query like this, it sparked something in my head from back in my reverse engineering days. And I took a look at the complex query, and if there's any reverse engineers in the audience, this should sort of resemble a YAR signature, like the YAR condition at the bottom. And I was like, wow, that's brilliant. And that leads to the next point, that whenever we were talking about this in the lab, we were saying reverse engineers for static binary analysis, they have YAR signatures. For IR, we have indicators of compromise. But what do we have to identify things that are of significant forensic significance? And then so we were wondering, what format are we going to put this in? And messing around with the Elasticsearch DSL, we're able to do this. So with the indicators of compromise and the YAR signatures, you have a certain amount of functionality available to you. With analysis, you can do with that. What do we have available for forensics? Well, with Apache Lucene, we can have Boolean operators in the string itself, not just combining the objects, but actually in the query string. Oldie but a goodie, wildcards. You guys know how to use wildcards. A phrase query is a string around quotes. It'll search that whole phrase. And that's not very complex. But the really interesting thing is the next one, proximity queries. You can actually search for those individual words out of order with the edit distance of whatever you specify, one or greater. That if the words are out of order, that will still match. Fuzzy queries are awesome. This example, you know, you have those malicious iterations of SVC host, SCV host, and SVC host with a zero. This uses the Levenstein distance to find iterations of a string. So we can find those, use this to find those malicious executable names. A range query is really useful for event logs. So that would be all the user activity in the security event logs. Regular expression, what would we do without regular expression? We would be hard coding file paths. You don't have to do that. There's an example of that will match both program files and program files x86, as well as what we covered in the last slides, that you can combine these objects together and keep adding to them with your different conditions. And then also, since we keep it in the query string format, it can be used in Kibana. We can just add those all up, convert it back to a query string, pop it in Kibana, and then go from there. So now that we can make a query, Andrea's gonna show us what we can do with that and do some really cool analysis with it.
So aggregations, why do we use aggregations? Well, aggregations let us do analytics on a search. They are performed at search time, and the way they work is they build buckets, classifying all your data entries in Elasticsearch. And there's so many types of aggregations you can use. I'm gonna show you some examples, but you have the terms aggregations. Those are based on a field, and they take into account all the possible values that that field can have within your data set. Then you have the date histogram to just get a really nice timeline overview of your case. Metrics, that's if you have like fields that contain numbers, you can calculate averages, standard deviations, and so many other mathematical operations. You have also the geobound ones. That is if you have like latitude and longitude coordinates within your data sets, that those are two values that you have ingested, you can do aggregations on those to see how many data are related to a country or a region or a city, stuff like that. There's so many more. And with the newer version of Elasticsearch, they have built even more types of aggregations, which is cool. But the coolest part is that you can nest them. You can nest different types of aggregations to output a really nice set of data, like analytics. So how do we build these aggregations? First, you create the query. Brian already told you how to. You just import the queue object, and we here have all the MFT entries. And then you create your aggregation, the top level one. You import the aggregation object from the Elasticsearch wonderful DSL library. And here we have a terms aggregations on the extension field of the MFT entries. And then we are both of them to the search object. So when you add, here's how you add the query and the aggregation to the search. But when you add the aggregation, you actually have to specify the name that you are giving to that top level aggregation. Here, the one that makes the most sense is extensions, since we're filtering on the field extension. And finally, you just execute your search, and you obtain the result back from Elasticsearch. So what we can do with all these? You can ask all sorts of forensic questions. Maybe you can ask how many different files are on the file system per file extension. And to access that result, that information, you just do a simple iteration of the result object. Take into account that you have to put there the name of the top level aggregation. And then you can just print the buckets and the count inside each bucket. This is how I see it working on my mind. You have all the MFT entries. You find one MFT entry which is associated to a file with extension HTML. You put it in a bucket. You find another one. You put it in a bucket. You find another one, and so on. And you end up having like all the different file extensions with the counts associated with it. But you can add even more forensic value to it. You can nest this aggregation and answer the next forensic question. How many files are created on a daily basis on the per file extension? So here we have the same thing, all the MFT entries. And now we're gonna use a date histogram to group the data entries in Elasticsearch per day. And we add a child bucket, and that's the same one we used before, but now it's no longer the parent one, it's the child. And it's the fields on extensions. And we add our query to the search, we add our aggregation to the search, and now we add the name for the parent one is dates MFT. You only need that one. And you execute the search, take back the result, and bam, all the files created per day, per file extension. You're probably wondering what happened on January 1st. That's actually from a real case that we were working on. And we had this coworker working on this image, and we saw this result, all these like 81, 82, 83 files being created on January 1st. What is that? Were you busy on January 1st? That's what we asked our coworker, and it's like, no, that was like January 1st, it's holiday. And someone apparently created an image on the system, like on the custodian's system. That's pretty interesting, and he told us that another company came before to do like forensics acquisitions of all the images that were involved in the case, and apparently they were not using any external device to store the images, which was pretty like mind-blowing.
Thanks for overriding Slack space for us.
Taking all the evidence out, whatever.
We appreciate it.
So let's move on, let's go farther and answer another question. How many users logged into the system? Which user accounts? How they did login? So again, now we move on from the MFT records, we go to the Windows events, especially the 4624, the login events. So we have our alt security events, and then we have our date histogram with the days on which those events occur. We group them on usernames, and each username is logging in using a different login type. So this is how all the data is gonna be bucketed in our aggregation. And again, we add our aggregation to our search using the parent name aggregation, execute it, and we have all the results. All the usernames that log on into the machine per day and which logon type they use. If they use different ones, it will show up there, like in the 31st of March, 2012. Here is a really good equivalence between these aggregations on Elasticsearch DSL and Kibana, because what it actually is doing is the same thing. It's an aggregation per day. You see the timestamp on the x-axis, and then you split the area into target usernames, which are the usernames used, and the logon types. So the different colors that you see here are the different logon types per username. And each chart is a different username that was logging into the machine. And here you can play with the dates and everything. So really, like, we have a lot of information, a lot of tools here, but what does all mean?
So applying the Elasticsearch DSL to what we're doing in the lab, we're able to manage all of our forensic inquiries into groups based on our common tasks like insider threat, incident response, and just general forensic questions. And that led to a more consistent analysis across all of our forensic investigators, having this information available, as well as a more rigorous analysis. I'll give you an example. You know, you may look for user activity in the event logs, but are you checking for if the event logs are cleared every time? Do you know where to check for that for EVTX? Do you know where for EVT? You know, we don't memorize every single thing we need to check every single time. So have this all down and available for the investigator to search. This is also extensible. Since we have these queries, if a new artifact comes out for a new operating system or new research comes out, we just create another query for that artifact, add it on to our list of queries, and just keep building on top of that. And since it's built on Elasticsearch, it's scalable. We can ingest many indices and then search across them. For like big investigations, and also it's extremely fast, so we get these answers in a very timely basis. So thank you, and are there any questions?
That was definitely awesome, especially like visualizing how how events are happening on a network or on a system. And so you're mentioning you can put multiple indices. Can you combine multiple systems? Like you can get all 30 systems involved in an investigation, then run a query and say, show me all the times this suspicious log on or this suspicious user logged on across all the systems, and kind of visualize a timeline like that. Is that something that you're able to do?
Yeah, so I should clarify that. So yeah, you can at the index level have that machine, and then there's an alias functionality in Elasticsearch, which is basically just a pointer. So you could point to 5, 10, 15, whatever machines, search on that one, and with Elasticsearch DSL, the events, the results that are returned, you can access the actual index within the metadata of it, so that you are able to determine individual machines from that timeline.
Awesome, thank you.
Any other questions? Everybody's probably downloading and getting ready to install Elasticsearch is probably what's really happening right now. Well, excellent. Well, thanks very much.
Very good talk.